हेलो फ्रेंड्स, नमस्ते मित्रों। तो आपका स्वागत है पेट्रोज्ञान वीडियो सीरीज में। प्लीज पहले आप सब्सक्राइब करिए, बिकॉज़ वी आर ओनली रिमेनिंग 250 सब्सक्राइबर्स फॉर 1.5K सब्सक्राइबर्स। सो प्लीज सब्सक्राइब यूट्यूब चैनल। इफ यू लाइक वीडियो प्लीज डू लाइक एंड कमेंट फॉर एनी सजेशंस। सो टुडेज टॉपिक इज सरफेस फैसिलिटी 2.0। इन फर्स्ट सरफेस फैसिलिटी वीडियो वी कवर्ड द बेसिक पार्ट ऑफ योर production operations in onshore and offshore, and we also covered the processing part and separation part. So this is the basically content for your today's video lecture. First, starting with the heater treater, then desalter, dehydration, gas desweetening, crude storage, your liquid measurements means your flow meters will be covered, flare mist, flare system, and vapor recovery in your upstream. Before going to the refinery, any value-added product recovery is done. Then I will cover then GCP, your gas compression plant. So these are the topics which should be covered for your interview purpose and your GATE for both. Now heater treater. So heater treater is the equipment which used for the secondary separation. Primary separation done is in your three-phase separation. So now to understand the heater treater, first we have to understand the emulsion, how emulsion forms. So to form the emulsion, there are the basically three requirements, which is basically already present in our your production system, means you are from your perforation to your stock tank. So first condition is two liquids should be immiscible. So your water and oil is immiscible to each other. Second condition is there must be a sufficient agitation or agitation to disperse one liquid as a droplet in another. So yeah, agitation is there at the choke or at the any point where your fluid is changing the direction or changing the momentum. So agitation is already present in our production system. So second parameter is also there to form the emulsion. Third parameter is there must be an emulsifying agent. So yeah, emulsifying agent is already present in our crude oil. I will discuss about the what are the emulsifying agents are present. Now direct emulsion. So in most of the conditions, means you're in heater treater, there will be a your direct condition, because the base phase is your crude oil. So your water are finally dispersed in your crude oil. Reverse emulsion is that in which your water is dispersed in your oil. So your primary phase or your base phase is your oil. So direct emulsion case is basically occur in heater treater, and your reverse emulsion case is basically occur in your ETPs, your effluent treatment plant or effluent treatment tanks. So these are the two types of emulsion which are basically basically present in your oil and gas industry. Now unstable emulsion and stable emulsion. So unstable emulsion are the usually formed by the mechanical action like the agitation, stringing, fluidization. On the settling, the emulsion breaks easily due to the manufacturers and your difference in your density gradients. So this unstable type of emulsion is basically treated in your primary separation, means in your separator, three-phase separator. Now stable emulsion. So to basically treat the stable emulsion, we required a heater treater. Now in stable emulsion, you can easily look in this figure that Michelin-like structure is formed, in which your heads are hydrophilic, which are basically attracted to the water, and your tails are basically hydrophobic, which is basically attracted to the oil. So that's why this Michelin type of structure form in stable emulsion. And these are the stable emulsion are due to the viscoelastic interfacial film formed by the action of chemical at the intrinsic level. So these chemicals are basically known as your emulsifying agents. So the asphaltene and resins are the basic emulsifying agents which are present in our crude oil. So this is the basically satisfying our second parameter. First parameter is the two fluids must be immiscible. Yeah, there are the immiscible fluids. Now second parameter is also satisfied by your emulsifying agents, which are the already present in your crude oil. Opposite to the emulsifier, there are the de-emulsifier, which are the basically class of the chemical used to add the separation of your emulsion. So this de-emulsifier are basically used in your heater treater. So in heater treater is basically work on basically three process. First one is, as the name suggests, heating. By the heating, we try to break the emulsion. Second one is by dosing the de-emulsifier, and third one is by the electrostatic separation. So let's understand the demulsifier, which type of demulsifier are used in basically oil industry. So chemicals with the surfactant properties, surfactant properties. So it's the basic phenomena of your demulsifiers. Now these demulsifiers are based on your ethylene oxide or your propylene oxide block polymers, resins with the fatty acid amide. EO means your ethylene oxide, which will increase your water solubility, and your propylene oxide, which will basically increase your oil solubility. So EO and PO are the basically base block polymers. Now, which type of chemicals are used? So acid catalyst, phenol, formaldehyde resins are used. So this type of resins are not act as your emulsifiers, but it act as a demulsifiers, because these are the resins which having the property of your surfactant. Now the polyamides, diepoxides, and polyols. So these are the these all are the basically polymers. Now the new and in recent time, the demulsifier which are the best are the polyesteramides. They are basically obtained by the polycondensation of EO and PO block polymers, means your ethylene oxide and propylene oxide condensation, which is basically which product is basically your polymer. So how this polyacrylamide will demulsifying the emulsion? So here a polyacrylamide structure is given, which is basically go to the center of your resin, means your emulsion, and this chemical allows the coagulation of micron oil droplet by a bipolar protonation followed by the flocculation and agglomeration. So this is the basically chemical and physical process which occur at the molecular level and which caused your demulsification of your emulsion. This micelle like structure is your emulsion. Now dosing of demulsifiers. So dosing pump, there are the dosing pump which are basically low volume pump and with the controllable discharge rate that are used to inject the additives or difficult to mix fluids like your demulsifiers. These demulsifiers are basically skid mounted pumps which is used to mix your demulsifier before into the crude oil before your crude oil is going to the heater treater. Now heater treater. So heater treater is basically equipment which used for your secondary separation. Your primary separation is already done in your separator. So your separator can reduce your BSNW, means your basic sediments and water, up to the 5% or 2.5%. Now from 5 to 2.5% to reduce the BSNW up to 0.2, your heater treater is used in your oil industry. Now I already discussed that three type of process or three type of treatment are carried out in heater treater. As the name suggests, first one is heating. By the heating, we can easily break the emulsion physically. Demulsifying addition. So by addition of demulsifier, the demulsification is done to break the emulsion chemically. Now electrostatic separation. This type of so basically two type of heater treater are there, with the electrostatic separation or with the non-electric electrostatic separation. To get the more low BSNW, we required electrostatic separation, which basically use the principle of your collision of your water droplets with each another and make the water droplet heavier or larger to settle it down by the gravity. So these are the three processes or three treatments which are occurred in your heater treater. Now heater treater is pressure vessel consisting of the four section. First section is inlet degassing section. So same as separator, your inlet degassification is done. second one is your heating section, in which your fire tube is there, which basically same as your bath heater, works as a bath heater, and which basically heat your crude oil. Third section is differential oil control system, which is basically same as your oil wheel and water wheel, which is used in three-phase separation. And third and additional section is collising section, which is basically use your electrostatic principle to collise your water droplets with each another. Now, instrumentation of your heater treater. So yeah, there is your pressure safety valve is there at your gas outlet, or PCV, your pressure control valve is there. For your water and oil outlet, there are the LCVs, level control valves, and LT, level transmitter, is there. By which it will give the signal to outlet of your oil and water. Now burner gas firing controlled by the temperature controller or TC. So here there are the three controller. First one is your level controller LC. Second one is your pressure controller PC, and third one is your temperature controller, which you already set at a specific temperature. It will adjust your burner gas firing, and it will increase or decrease your temperature. Now oil level control is done by LT, your level transmitter. Water level is means your, there are the basically two types of LT. First one is your oil level control. For your oil level control, LT is there, your level transmitter is there. And for your water level control, means your water outlet, you use basically interface level transmitters, your ILTs. It is basically modification of your name, same as LT. And system pressure control, for the gas outlet, your PCVs are there. Emulsions and its stability. So the emulsion, the stability of emulsion in heater treater is basically depends on five parameters, in which first one is the difference in density between the oil phase and the water phase. So first parameter is not controllable by us. Second parameter is the size of dispersed water particles. So yeah, this we can control by the electrostatic collision. By the electrostatic collision, we can increase the size of dispersed water droplets. Third one is viscosity. So yeah, by the heating, we can change the viscosity of oil phase. Fourth one is interface tension. So by adding the surfactant or your demulsifying agent, we can change the surface tension. And the fifth one is the presence and concentration of emulsifying agents. So here in crude oil, emulsifying agents like asphaltenes and resins. So their concentration is also depend on the stability of emulsion is also depend on their concentration. Now reason of water removal from the crude oil. So the crude oil supply to the refinery have minimum 0.2 BSNW, should be have minimum 0.2 BSNW. So that's why we have to reduce the water percentage from the crude oil. Second parameter required by the refinery is salinity must be less than 50 mg per liter. So salinity of crude oil is basically by the emulsified water. So by reducing this emulsified water, we can reduce the salinity below the 50 mg per liter. To avoid the shipping of emulsified oil, which cause transportation capability by the undesired water. So yeah, total transportation volume will be higher if your water is emulsified in the oil. And also the technology required for the transport of such mixture of emulsion is also costlier. So the volume is also high and technology is also costlier. So that's why it will require a heater treater before the transferring of crude oil to the refinery. Third one is the free water can accumulate in the low points of the pipeline. So yeah, I already discussed this water can be accumulated at the any point of the pipeline, and if this water will accumulate for longer time, it will corrode the pipeline, or maybe hydrate formation will be there. Fourth one is viscosity of crude oil increase as the water content is increased. So yeah, for the emulsified crude oil, by the emulsing of the crude oil, the viscosity will increase. Fifth one is mineral salt presence in the oil fields. Water corrode the production equipment, pipelines, tankers, and storage. So I have already discussed this emulsified water will corrode the production equipment like separator and all, pipelines, tankers, and storage tanks. And last one is refining of water in the crude oil can cause the server corrosion and plugging problems in the refinery's equipment. What's the heat treater? So let's start with the heating section. So in heating section, basically heat treating is being done, and this heat treating is because to reduce the oil viscosity and enhance the collision. So as we reduce the viscosity, stability of immersion is also reduced. Cause of thermal expansion of droplets, which basically cause the rupture of film and help to collide. So collision of this water molecules is basically restricted by this film. So if we heat the emulsion, the droplet will rupture by the rupturing of the film, and it cause the collision. Add dispersion of emulsified agent into the oil phase. So for the dispersion of by the heating, we can disperse the emulsifying agent into the oil phase. Now create current, thermal current of water movement and collision. So as we know that heat conduction convection will cause the thermal current, and due to that water molecule will collide. And after all, if water molecule can able to collide to each other, its size will increase and gravity separation will be done. Now heat input in the heat treater. So heat input required to the heat treater is Q naught plus QW plus Q loss. Here QO is means heat required for the oil, heat required for the water, and the thermal efficiency of heat treater is not 100%, so that's why Q loss is to be in consideration. Now let's assume that Q loss is 10% of total heat, and for the mass per hour calculation, we can do easily by the 350 for the water. The density is 350 lb pound per barrel. So this is the density of water. So 350 by 24 into specific gravity into the Q will give the mass flow rate per hour for the water. And as we know, the heat transfer equation Q is equal to mass flow rate into specific heat into delta T. So specific heat for the oil is 0.5 and for the water it's 1. So this equation will come. So this is the basically total heat required in the heat treater. So it will also help to calculate the gas flow rate which is used in the burning tube or your fire tube. Now gravity separation. So two forces are equal, a constant velocity is reached. When two forces are equal, a constant terminal velocity will reach, and this computed by the Stokes law. So this is the basically your terminal velocity, where the larger particles droplet, the larger square, and it will increase the basically downward velocity, and that's the bigger droplet will easily collide and easily settle by the gravity separation. The greater the difference between the density, the velocity is also high. So it will also increase the downward velocity of the water, and it will basically help to reduce the emulsion. Third one is higher the temperature. So as the higher the temperature, lower the viscosity of oil phase is there. So it will basically increase the downward velocity of the water, and as your heat treater temperature is high, it will help to reduce the emulsion easily. So as your temperature is high, easy the separation of emulsion will be done. Now second process in the heat treating system in heat treater is collision. The process of collision is basically in oil treating system is basically time dependent. In the dispersion of two immiscible fluid, immediate collision seldom occurs when two droplets collide. If droplet pair is exposed to the turbulent pressure fluctuations and the kinetic energy of oscillations induced in the oscillation droplet pair is larger than the energy of adhesion between them, then the contact will be broken before the collision is occur. So collision will not occur. So the time of collision is dependent on the diameter of droplet, the volume fraction of dispersed phase, and the empirical parameter which basically connect with the temperature and the all other parameters. Now as your droplet size increasing, your time of collision will increase, NS, the volume fraction of dispersed phase, volume fraction of dispersed phase is dispersed phase upon the total volume. If the if water emulsion, if there is a high water emulsion in the crude oil, then the time for collision will reduce. So this is the second process occur in the heat treater. Now second process which will occur in the heat treater is demulsification. So demulsification is already discussed in the demulsifiers. Now the third section is horizontal electrostatic treater. Now electrostatic treating is done by the two electrodes. These electrodes may be having a AC voltage or DC voltage. The water droplets become the polarized and tend to the align themselves in the electric field. In AC field, small droplets vibrate over a large distance. Due to the back and forth motion of the droplets will collide to each other, and this causes the rupture of the skin of emulsifying agent and collision settle down due to the high volume or high mass of the droplet. In DC field, the water droplet will collect at the electrode and eventually fall by the gravity. So in DC field, your positive electrode is at the downside, so your water molecule is directly attracted to the electrode and it will fall by the gravity. The attraction between the droplets in the electric field is given by this formula. Just remember this formula, there is no need of calculation for this. So this is all electrostatic. So here with the end of electrostatic section, we are ending the heat treater section. Now desalter. Now crude oil desalting. So as we know that heat treater can reduce BSNW, means your water content minimum up to 0.2. So there must be some emulsified water in the crude oil. Now these salts are basically these salts can be dissolved in only water. Salts are not present in the crude oil. So this 0.2% of your emulsion is basically giving you high saline crude oil. Now what is the requirement of desalination of a crude oil? So this is the basically as refinery need BSNW less than 0.2, refinery has also required 50 mg minimum salinity of 50 mg per liter. So why this desalination is required for the refinery? So deposit of scales will occur at the downstream equipments, means your refinery equipments. Deactivation of your catalyst bed. So catalyst beds are used in basically columns in the refinery. So it basically deactivate the catalyst beds, and salt will accelerate the corrosion of your piping equipment in your downstream. So this, because of these three reasons, we require crude oil desalination. So as we all know that salt are present in water only, so it's basically dehydration. By adding some fresh water, we can reduce the salinity of your emulsified water in the crude oil. So desalination is basically mainly reduction of salinity of your crude oil, which is basically occurred and consists of three steps. First one is adding a fresh water to the crude oil. Second one is mixing the dilute water with the crude oil to dilute the saline water. And last one is emulsion treating or second stage dehydration to separate the crude oil and brine. Now in two stage desalination, it required water injection rate less than your single stage desalination. It is almost 5 to 7% of your crude oil flow rate. Now you can assume that only 0.2% of water is present in crude oil, and you are adding 5 to 7% fresh water to the your well fluid or your crude oil. So it will basically reduce your salinity by a very great factor, and this mixing is occurred under your mixing tree. Okay, mixing tea, which basically mix the fresh water and it dilute the fresh water into the crude oil, and it will give a shear for the dispersion of your water droplets into the fresh water droplets into the crude oil, because dispersed water droplets can only collide with the saline droplets. So this is the basic. Now this is your basically crude oil desalination plant, which consists of three phase separator only. Now before entering the crude oil into the or mixing to the fresh water, crude oil is heated to the 120 degree Celsius temperature. Now fresh water is mixing by the tea, which is mixing tea, which basically agitate your water into the crude oil. Now this mixture will go to the separator. In separator, due to the high temperature, good separation will occur, and separation is done into the three phase. First, it separates the pure crude oil, means your crude oil with the 0.2 maximum up to 0.2 BSNW, then your water and the emulsion. So emulsion is separately separated, water is separately separated, and your desalted crude oil is differently separated. Now this water, which is basically coming from your three phase separation outlet, which is having a higher temperature of up to 130 to 150 degrees Celsius, there is a heat exchanger is there, which basically give a heat to the fresh water, which is we are feeding in the your upstream. And this due to the heat exchanger, your temperature decreases up to 50 degree temperature, and by using the cooling water or cooling by the air, we can reduce this water temperature up to the 30 degree, and we can divert it to the ETP, effluent treatment plant. Now this brine is handled separately by your heater treater. There will be another heater treater. So this is a basically desalinated plant. Dehydration, dehydrated processing. So the most common additives basically used are methanol, ethylene glycol, your diethylene glycol. Methanol is the most common one, which is used in industry or chemical industry, because it dissolves well in the gas stream and is readily available in bulk, less expensive, consequently does not require any recovery or regeneration. Now dehydration can be occurred by the absorption or adsorption. So absorption dehydration involves the use of liquid desiccant to remove the vapor from the gas. Although many liquid possess the ability of absorption of water from the gas, the liquid is the liquid which has most desirable to use in commercial dehydration purpose in oil and gas industry possesses the main five following properties. So starting with the high absorption property, so liquid desiccant should have high absorption efficiency. Second one is easy economical regeneration, it should be easily regenerated. Third one is non-corrosive and non-toxic to your equipments. Fourth one is no operational problems when used in high concentration. And last one is no interaction with the hydrocarbon portion of gas and no contamination by the acid gases. So that should be not chemical reaction between the hydrocarbon gases and that absorption liquid desiccants. Now the glycol particularly used, mainly used in oil and gas industry, are ethylene glycol, diethylene glycol, triethylene glycol, and tetraethylene glycol. In basically offshore and in basically western offshore, we use TEC, triethylene glycol, as our liquid desiccants come closest, and these all glycols are come closest to satisfy the criteria to varying degrees. Glycol are preferred because they offer a superior dew point depression with the process reliability and the low initial cost. So initial capex is also low, and your opex, your operating cost, is also low in your glycol case. So that's why we are using the glycols in dehydration absorption method in our oil and gas industry. And generally triethylene glycol is mainly used. Now compressed gas is dehydrated in the glycol contactor. So here there is a two bottles. First one is glycol contractor and second one is glycol regenerator. I will explain how the process. So let's directly start with the process. So starting from the here. So here the compressor outlet is there, which basically inlet for your dehydration plant. Starting with the inlet separator, means Collier separator, which basically separates the higher bigger molecules or bigger droplets of the water. There is a tank also there, where basically your your water is separated, and gas will directly go to your glycol contractor. So this volume bottle is your basically glycol contractor, and this is your glycol regenerator. So from here, glycol
your lean glycol is injected is basically pumping the this column, your glycol contractor column, and there is a bubble cap trays are there. So your glycol will flow downward in downward direction, and your gas will flow in upward direction. So that's why absorption can happen. Now dry gas means after the removal of your water droplets or your after the dehydration of gas will flow in upward direction, and from top it will go to the glycol scrubber. So this scrubber is required because there must be some glycol droplets in your gas stream. To remove these glycol droplets, there is a glycol scrubber is there, and from that your gas is directly supplied to the your lift gas or your gas injection, your lift gas injection plant or your gas injection plant. Now for the glycol, there is a glycol regenerator. Now glycol is coming here from the your circulation pumps, which basically pump your glycol, and before going glycol into the circulation pump, there are the booster pumps are there. So rich glycol is coming down from the your contactor, and it directly goes to the heat exchanger part. It directly go to the heat exchanger because after the regeneration of your glycol, your lean glycol is heated by the reboiler, so its temperature is higher than your rich glycol. So in contactor, if temperature is high of your rich glycol, it will be easy to separate the your water and glycol. So that's why there are the heat exchanger, which basically takes heat from your lean glycol and give to the rich glycol. Now this rich glycol will directly go to the your regeneration column, where basically your trays are there, your bubble cap trays are there, and where basically separation will be done, and there are the flash drums. This flash drum is basically for your initial for your initial separation of your water and your glycol by the expansion of stream. So this is the whole process. Now adsorption dehydration. Now adsorption dehydration is the process where the solid desiccant is used for the removal of water vapor from the gas stream. The solid desiccants commonly used in for the gas dehydration are the that can be easily regenerated, same as your liquid desiccants. Consequently, used for the several adsorption and desorption cycles. So that there should be a longer life of your solid desiccants. So some solid desiccants can dehydrate gas up to 1 ppm. So yeah, this is a very good range of your for the gas, because why we need the dehydration of the gas, because we are using this gas into the gas lift, or we are giving it to consumer. So there is a requirement by the consumer that this should be a minimum ppm for your dehydrated gas, and we are also injecting it to the wells, or we are using in a gas lift. So in gas lift we are using basically ADC in your gas lift line, which is connected to your annulus. At ADC means your adjustable choke. So here at the choke, your Joule-Thomson effect will be done, because at the choke your velocity will be very high, so there will be a low pressure. So that's why your gas stream will be cooled. So if your gas stream contain the water vapor, then the hydrate formation or gas icing, in oil and gas industry we use the gas icing or hydrate formation will happen in the gas lift line. So that's why we need to reduce your water vapor up to 1 ppm. So this solid desiccants are the which can reduce your hydration up to the 1 ppm, means 1 parts per million. These desiccants are widely used to feed the stream of cryogenic processing. Type of adsorbents used in solid desiccants, basically used in your adsorption dehydration. So starting from the bauxite. So bauxite is the primary consists of bauxite, most of the primary solid desiccants, then your alumina, alumina silica gels, silica alumina gels, and then your molecular sieves. Activated carbon is also basically type of adsorbent or solid desiccant only, but it is having a no capacity to adsorb the water, and therefore this your activated carbon can be used for the dehydration purpose. Basically your activated carbon is used as an adsorbent only in your RO to remove the certain impurities. So that's why your activated carbon can't be used in oil and gas industry for the dehydration purpose. Now the bauxite is also having a problem because it contains the iron. So this iron will react with the sour gas, and so that's why your bauxite is not also very good for your dehydration. Now this is basically a plant of your solid desiccant adsorption. Same here, your inlet separator is there. Your inlet separator will separate the initial like big molecule or larger molecule of your water vapor. Then there is a column of drying and regeneration. So this column will one should work as a drying and one should work as a regeneration. So just understand the plant. There is the same process which happen in liquid absorption for the liquid desiccant. Now swimming process of the gas stream. So why there is a need of first let's understand what is sweetening of your gas stream. So removing of acidic gas like CO2 and H2S is the basically sweetening process. So why is the need of sweetening process? So if we want to transport the gas stream with the H2S and CO2, it will corrode to your pipeline and it will also corrode your storage tanks or any equipment which we are basically processing for the gas. So that's why there is a need to removal of H2S and CO2 before the transportation. So the processes that have been developed to accomplish the gas purification vary from the simple one like water wash to complex multi-step recycle systems. In many cases, the process complexity arises when you need recovery or in form of one or another form of the removal of H2S being removed or recovery of the materials employed to the remove it. Now the complexity will arise when you need to recycle or reuse the substance which you use for absorption and adsorption. So same like dehydration, here desulfurization process primarily consists of two, absorption and adsorption method. So this adsorption may be have a chemical or physical adsorption, or your absorber may use a physical or chemical one. So in adsorption basically we use the solid desiccants, and for absorption we use the wet process or your liquid desiccants. There are the few process that use other method also, such as the cellulose acetate membranes that rely upon the different diffusion rates of your hydrocarbon and H2S, the liquid fractorization technique that exploit the relatively volatility difference. The application of this later type of techniques like cellular acetate membranes are very less in oil industry. Basically we use absorption and adsorption methods only for the sweetening process. Both absorption and adsorption process may be your physical one or chemical one. I already discussed that both process may be having a physical or chemical one. Physical means your water valves or select, so I will explain. And in chemical, basically your chemical reaction is going on. So first of all, let's understand the physical absorption method. So in which there are basically two methods. First one is water wash and second one is selection. So water wash is the simple method in which we basically use a water bath for the removing of acidic gas, and for the selection process we use a selection bath for the removal of your H2S and CO2. This both physical absorption methods are not selective. They will remove your H2S and CO2 as well. Both they will remove. So here there is a no need of regeneration. So there is a single tower named as a contactor in which your water bath or your selector bath will happen. So from top your water will go down. Here also the bubble type trays are there. In your gas stream will go from downwards to the upward direction.
and it causes the physical absorption. And after that, your lean water or your clean water or your lean silicone will become a rich in H2S and CO2. Then after, there are the two flash drums which basically we use in water wash. So this this diagram is for the water wash. For siloxal, we can use two or three flash drums. In water wash, basically we use the two flash drums only. So this is the basically physical absorption method. Now the solid sweetening process, solid bed sweetening. So solid bed sweetening process are the basically adsorption type processes, in which there are also the chemical adsorption and physical adsorption is there. So let's understand first ion sponge process. Ion sponge process is basically your chemical adsorption. The sore gas is passed through the bed of wood chips that have been impregnated with the special type of hydrated form of ferric oxide, means your Fe2O3, that has been highly affinity, highly attraction to the H2S, and the chemical reaction will form. Chemical reaction is Fe2O3 plus 3 H2S will give you ferrous oxide, your Fe2S3 plus 3 H2O. So the temperature must be less than 120 degree Fahrenheit, because this method given by the coal and the resin field. So if your temperature is greater than 120, then there will be a neutral or acidic condition lead the loss of water of your crystallization of ferric oxide. So it will damage your ferric oxide and the bed will become very difficult to regenerate. So after that, you can't regenerate the reuse the or recycle the ion sponge bed. So and the regeneration cycle is also chemical method, chemical process, in which you basically flow air from the highly means your from the ferric oxide, ferric sulfate. So to Fe2O3 plus 3O2 will give you again ferric oxide. So this is the basically ion sponge method. Here we use basically two towers. First one is for the your adsorption, and second one is your recycle. After that, you change your recycle one. After that, you can use for the adsorption method. So this is the basically ion sponge method. Now molecular sleeves. So molecular sleeves are basically example of physical adsorption. So synthetically manufactured molecular sleeves form of crystalline sodium calcium amino silicates. Molecular sleeves are basically porous in the structure and having a large surface area. So in these pores, your acidic gases like H2S and CO2 will fit, and it will filtrate the pure gas. Now the pores are formed by the removal of crystalline water and are uniform throughout the material. So these pores are uniform throughout the material. Several grades of molecular sleeves are available, depends on their pore size. So you can use fine type of pore size, and you can use larger size of pore size. So this will change the grade of your molecular sleeves. Now chemical absorption. So chemical absorption process is basically the alkylamine process, which is basically mostly used and predominantly used in oil and gas industry. So alkylamine process are the most prominently and widely used processes for the H2S and CO2 removal. They offer a good reactivity at low cost and good flexibility in the design and operation. Some of the commonly used alkylamine are the monoethylene ethanolamine, diethanolamine, your tetraethanolamine, then diglycolamine, diisopropanolamine, your methyl diethanolamine. So these are the types of alkylamines which is used for the chemical absorption method. Now this chemical absorption is same as your dehydration. It's done in two columns. First one is for the absorption, and second one is for the regeneration of your liquid desiccants, means your alkylamine. So you can understand the there is no need of explanation of this process, but if you want, then you can understand from this diagram the processes of absorption by the alkylamines. And these are the basically, please remember the name of this alkylamines. This can be asked in the examination. Crude oil storage. So what need of crude oil storage? So there is a constant requirement by the refinery, and your production is not stable, like you will not get the production same at each hour. So So you should have some surplus volume to give a refinery. So that's why we need a storage, temporary storage facility at the upstream. Now, type of storage tanks. So there may be a vertical fixed roof tank. This vertical fixed roof tanks are basically used for your non-volatile fluids. And for crude oil, yeah, you can use the vertical fixed roof type tank. And at the GGS, this vertical fixed type two tanks are only used normally, and their volume capacity is 100 meter cube. Now, vertical floating roof type can be also used for the volatile liquids like naphtha, LPG. Your horizontal overground bullets, means your horizontal small vessels can be used for the small volume storage facility. This storage facility, these horizontal overground bullets are used in your test after your test separator, means your test storage tank. For the production testing, you are using the horizontal ground bullets, which are basically of 45 meter cube. Their volume generally in GGS is 45 meter cube. Now, underground storage for the safe handling of your crude oil. Now, mobile vessels to transport crude oil from one to another place. There may be a rail wagons, or there be a road tankers are there. So this is the basically type of storage facilities. Now at the GGS, always there are the fixed roof tank or your floating roof tank, depends on your type of crude oil. Okay, so here we can divide the petroleum products into three class. Class A, flammable liquid having a flash point below 23. So for below 23, we can use the floating roof tank, storage tank. And for B and C, so your flaming if your flaming liquid having a flash point between 23 to 65 and above 65 to the 93, your liquid, your fuel will be classified as a class B and class C. So for that, you can use the fixed roof tank. Now, your fixed roof tanks consist of cylindrical shell with the permanently welded roof that can be flat, conical, or domed. So roof may be a cone, dome, or umbrella type, or maybe a flat. Such tanks are used to store a material with a true vapor pressure less than your 10.3 kilopascal. So if your vapor pressure is less than your 10.3 true vapor pressure, then you can use a fixed roof tank. Now the nominal volume is from 100 to 10,000 meter cube, or up to 1 lakh, up to 1 lakh meter cube, you can have your fixed roof tank. Working media, oil and oil products, not steam pressure more than your 93.3 kilopascal. Inside the media, density not more than 1.5 ton per meter cube. Your temperature up to 260 degrees Celsius, your internal pressure up to 5 or 6 kilopascals, and vacuum up to the 0.6 kilopascal. Now, fixed roof tanks having these more equipments. So gooseneck type, your vent is there, your flame arrestor is there, ladder is there, your main hole is there, your inlet nozzle or outlet nozzle is there, foam line is there, your float type indicator, which basically indicates the level, are there. So this is basically equipments used in your fixed roof tank. Now we have floating roof tank. So your floating roof tank can be a external floating or internal. So the in external floating type, the roof arise and the roof rise and falls with the liquid level in the tank. The roof has supported by the legs hanging down the liquid level. At the low liquid level, the roof will eventually land and same vapor space available between the liquid surface and roof. So your vapor space will be available same in any liquid level. For your internal floating level, these tanks are nothing but your cone roof tanks with a floating roof inside the tank. So here there are two roofs. One is same as a fixed roof tank, and there is another floating roof is there, which travels ups and down along with the liquid level. This floating roof tank, internal floating roof tank vapor traps the vapor from the flash point of fuels. Now, what are the risks and damages associated with the storage tanks? So fire outside can heating the your storage tank shell can be damaged, your roof can be damaged. Fire on top can cause the release of hydrocarbon vapor at the roof, and which will extend the fire. Now explosion inside the tank will basically cause by caused by the shell damage, or shell collapse can cause by your vacuum inside the tank. So there is a your limit of your vapor pressure and vacuum. So this tank should be maintained in that range, means your minimum pressure, means your vacuum limit, and your maximum vapor pressure that is given for a particular storage tank. So these are the possible type of damages are there. Now transportation of your oil and gas. So you can transport your oil in pressurized mode, in which from high pressure to low pressure your liquid or your any fluid like gas and liquid can easily flow from after high pressure to low pressure. For the stabilized mode, there are the centrifugal pumps and reciprocating pumps are there. Reciprocating pumps are basically using a piston and cylinder arrangement, suction and having a suction and discharge valves integrated into the pump. The most reciprocating pumps are maybe duplex or triplex type of reciprocating pump, and these pumps we can use in a by stage like 3-stage to duplex reciprocating pumps. Reciprocating pump are basically used when you require a low volume or high pressure discharge. Centrifugal pump can't be worked for a high pressure discharge. And one another limitation for reciprocating pump that if your valve fluid having a mixing of your gas, or if there is a gas contained in your liquid, then you can't use the reciprocating tank. At that time, you have to go for the centrifugal pump. So centrifugal pumps are rotodynamic pump which basically convert the mechanical energy into the hydraulic energy by the centripetal force on the liquid. Typically, rotating impeller increases the velocity of fluid, and the casing or volute will basically convert this velocity into the pressure energy, and that's how the centrifugal pump is work. So centrifugal pump can handle the gas volume up to some limit. So for that, for large volume and low pressure discharge, your centrifugal pumps are the best. Now wash tanks. So you all know that after all separation, these wash tanks are used. These wash tanks are used to separate the free oil from the produced water. So these wash tanks are basically in the ETP area. So it's a fixed or floating type of collection ports are there. Also, collection ports are known as your wire collectors. This wastewater is allowed to remain in the tank till oil and water separate out. So here, wash tanks are basically your works on the principle of your gravity separation. For the here, the timing. To store is very high than your separator. In your separator, your transition time is very less, means time between your inlet and outlet is very less, like 6 minutes or 4 minutes. It means your retention time here, your retention time is very high. Heating system are already there for the removal of your oil from the water, and so this is basically structure, your top view, side view, and bottom view of your wash tanks. So liquid measurements means your flow metering. So where we require the liquid measurements. So for particular well, we are doing a your production testing. At that time, we required a flow meter from one surface facility, how much liquid is coming, like from one GGS, how much liquid is coming to the CTF. For that, we required a flow meter. For one unmanned platform or for one valid platform, how much liquid or how much fluid is coming to the process platform, we required a liquid measurement. And after the sending the commodity to the refinery, we required a liquid measurement in between upstream and downstream. So there are the different types of flow meter available in the oil and gas industry. So basic two types of flow meters are there. First one is your mass flow meter, and second one is your volumetric flow meter. So your volumetric flow meter you can use for if your flow contain 100% pure phase, like 100% pure oil or 100% pure water or 100% pure liquid or 100% pure gas. Your mass flow meter you can use for finding the density of the fluid. For the finding the flow rate of the fluid, and for let's understand by the well fluid. So well fluid is a mixture of your oil, water, and gas. So to measure the quantity of each phase, we required a mass flow meter. For the mass flow meter, we have two types of flow meter. First one is Coriolis flow meter, and second one is MPFM. MPFM is multiphase flow meter, which basically use the gamma rays. Means your radioactive sensors are there, which will give you a direct percentage of water in the well fluid, percentage of oil in the well fluid, and percentage of gas in the well fluid. So and Coriolis meter will give a density and flow rate. So you can multiply the volume to the density, then you can have your mass flow rate, means mass flow per hour or mass flow per second. And another type is volumetric flow meter. So volumetric flow meters are different types of volumetric flow meters, starting with the PD, means a positive displacement meter, which is basically send a particular volume in a one reciprocation. So it will send a particular volume in a one reciprocation. So there are the different types of positive displacement meters, having a gears or having a piston like arrangement. Then DP meters. So DP is differential pressure meters. So you can use the orifice meter or Venturi meter. Means here we are using the Bernoulli principle. So we can use either for the 100% pure gas or 100% oil. We can use these delta P meters, which we give basically reading in the inch of water column. Then we multiply the K factor to the inch of water column to get the meter from your SCMD or BOPD, barrel oil per day, or your standard meter cube per day. For that, we have to multiply the K factor to the inch of water column. Third one is ultrasonic. So ultrasonic flow meter is also used for the 100% pure phase. It will give only the velocity of your stream. So you can multiply the area to the velocity and you can get your flow rate. And last one is your turbine flow meter. So this turbine flow meter is basically your rotary flow meter is there. So there is a turbine, and fixed volume with fixed velocity will give a certain RPM, and we are measuring basically RPM, and then we converting this RPM to the your flow rate, means your BOPD, means like barrel oil per day. We are converting this RPM to the flow rate. So these are the basically different types of flow meters are there. We have to understand what types of flow meters are there. So this is the only portion that I should cover for the gate. Now for the Coriolis flow meter will give you a mass flow rate, means your kg per second, or density and temperature. So this three quantity will be given as a result in Coriolis meter. So you can, if you get the density, then you can have the portion like there is a mixture of oil and gas is there. So you know the density of oil is 0.5 and density of water is 1. Your specific gravity. Then you can, if you are getting the resultant density is 0.75, then the fraction is 50-50%. So this is how we can use the Coriolis meter in our oil and gas industry. Now flare system. So flare are required for the safe disposal of gases in the event of process failure or your LP gas. So you the cost for compressing the LP gas is very high. So that's why you need a flaring system. Now the air and smokeless combustion is provided by the low pressure air assist fan located at the base of the stack, means your flare, and conducted to the flare tip in the annular space between the gas riser and the air outlet duct. The air outlet duct becomes a structural support for the stack, which can be self-supported or guided supported, or supported using a derrick structure, normally depending on the height of the flare. So this is basically a let's understand the flare system. So there is a requirement of removal of your heavier hydrocarbon liquid droplets or your water droplets. So that's why there is a flare KOD is there. And again, there is a main water seal drum is there. Here there is basically same function is done as done in your dehydration, that your gas will enter into the water, and water will make a emulsion of your oil substance or any hydrocarbon liquid droplet. So that's why and this oily water is transmitted to the oily water sewage system, and gas is directly
transferred to the your elevator flare derrick. Now there is a air inlet and fuel gas inlet for the FFG. FFG is basically front flare generator, where the basically specific amount of air and fuel are present, which required for the generation of flare front or fire front. So an electric by the electric signal, your flare front will be generated, and this flare will fire the your gas, and your gas will directly go to the top. Here top there is a flare arrestor is also there. Here fluidic seal system is also there. So that's why your liquid will not reach to the flare tip, and liquid will settle down. So from here, from the downward side of your flare column, your water and oily water will be transported to the oily water sewage system. So this is the basically flaring system used in onshore and offshore. Pigging operation basically refers in oil and gas industry, which basically use of pipeline pigs to clean or inspection of pipeline without stopping the operation. So these pipeline or risers are flowing in flowing condition. We are doing the pigging. So we are basically launching a pig, which is shape of like a capsule size, and it will travel through the pipeline and clean the inner walls by the brushing action. So this is the basically main function of pig and use of pigging. Now we can use spear type of pig, or your brush scraper without your brush pig. Then we can use the poly pig, gauge pig, and caliper pigs. So these are different types of pig, and we can also use the intelligent type of pig to basically inspection of your pipeline, that is if pipeline carry any break or any leakage is there. So that for that purpose we can use the intelligent pigging. Now pigging operation is basically done for these four major conditions. First one is separation of product. So if we want to if transport two product in a single pipeline, then we can use a pig to separate the products. So that's why pigging is used in multi product lines or for the dewatering. Now improving the flow efficiency. So improving the flow efficiency means removing the your flow assurance problems, like removal of your sand, asphaltene and bags, clearance of dirt and condensate from the gas lines. So in gas line there are the condensate deposition and hydrate formation there in the pipeline. So for that also we can use the pigs to basically improve the flow efficiency or to remove the your flow assurance problems. Then corrosion inhibitors. So we can batch the corrosion inhibitor after the pig, and so that pig was cleaning the walls, and so clean wall directly in contact with the corrosion inhibitor. So corrosion inhibitor will stop the corrosion. And last one is your meter proving. So for calibration of your flow meter, we can use also the pigs to basically check that how much volume is coming from the pipeline. Now the launching mechanism of your pig. So I will understand step by step. Let's understand. So first of all, close the valve A and C. So let's understand first of all the valves. So valve A is your pig. PBIB, pig barrel isolation valve. Your valve B is your scraper T, while C is your kickoff valve, while E is your vent valve, and while D is your drain valve. In spite of these all valves, there is another valve just called as a F valve, which is basically for using of your corrosion inhibitor dosing. So let's understand the launching procedure. So first check the valve A and valve C is closed. Then drain the launching trap by the opening of valve D and also opening by the vent valve E. So that's why we are depressurizing the pig barrel. When your pig barrel pressure is zero, so it will be shown in your pressure gauge. When your pig barrel pressure is zero, let's open the door and let's insert the pig into the pig barrel. Close the pig barrel. Fourth step is close the door safely. and close the drain valve D and open the, and keep open valve E. And to basically your gas can't be push your peak because gas is compressible. So that's why we need a pick barrel to fill with the liquid. So just keep valve E open and just crack open valve C means your kickoff valve. So it will basically fill the big barrel by venting out the air or gas. So you can fill the full peak with the liquid. So after that, please after that close the valve E and also close the valve C. Now first open valve A and then after that you can open valve C and after that you can close the scrapper T. So your fluid will be directly diverted to the like you are opening this PBIP your peak barrel isolation valve and you are first opening this kickoff valve. So some of your liquid will diverted to the liquid or gas will diverted to the kickoff line. Then close halfly close the your scrapper T valve or main bypass valve, which cause the diversion of your fluid to the kickoff line and which will basically give a kick to the your peak. Now same for the receiving. Let's understand the receiving. So close drain valve, close the drain valve. First of all, your drain valve should be closed. Fill the trap with the opening valve C and venting out venting through the valve E. So let's fill the your pick barrel with the liquid. Third is open valve C means your kickoff valve and open valve A also. After that, halfly close your scrapper T means your B valve B. So this cause diversion of fluid through first your fluid is going in this direction like from scrapper T it is going into the scrapper T valve. So now you are you have opened this PBIP your pick barrel isolation valve and you also open your kickoff valve. So that's why and you are closing halfly or quarterly your scrapper T. So that's why your fluid is diverted into the barrel. So your peak will be received in the barrel and your liquid is going through the kickoff line to the scrapper T. So basically this is your receiving mechanism. Now let's understand the additional or special plants which is used in pipe recovery. Pipe recovery means your value added product recovery. So recovery and option are basically your naphtha or your LPG. So basically your gas recovered from the well fluid contain C1 to C6 or C7 up to C7 it contained. So there are the condensate part is also there, your LPG, LPG means your C3 C4 is also there. So we can remove it for the remove it and use sell this value added product in our upstream business. So this is your basically your pipe recovery plant. You can call as your CFU or crude oil factorization unit. So here your gas will enter. So your inlet separator is there. Then there is a filter is there which remove the basically solid particles. Then LEF is there. This is basically to remove your C1, C2. So here in this column, basically there are the trays are there. Your bubble type trays are there. In which basically your C1, C2 will extract it and your C1, C2 after reflux drum, you go to the your reseller. So basically GAIL is basically main customer for the ONGC. So your C1 C2 is directly going to the customer. Now here your heavier particles means your from your C3 to C7 is transferred to the another contactor column which is basically known as LPG contactor in which basically your LPG means your lighter particles. So C3 to C4 is LPG here. So C3 to C4 is extruded in LPG contactor column, and in downward side with the by the use of reboiler, you can add your you can remove your valuated product name is naphtha. So naphtha is your from C5 to C7. So you can sell this naphtha to the local consumers, and you can sell your LPG by the bottling plant. You can transfer it to the bottles or your LPG tankers. So this is basically your CFU plant, means your crude oil fractionation unit. Now thank you friends, ये वीडियो को लाइक करिए, शेयर करिए और हमारे पेट्रोज्ञान यूट्यूब चैनल को सब्सक्राइब करिए, और फॉर मोर अपडेट्स फॉलो अस ऑन यूट्यूब एंड फेसबुक एंड इंस्टाग्राम. Thank you.